God, it's been a rough week. You know, sometimes messages flow and they're easy, and sometimes it's just a nightmare. And this was one of those weeks. And even up to this morning, I was up early last night. I was up early this morning and stayed up late last night and been messing around with it. I got like six messages in there. So we're gonna run with this today. And it's difficult because we're at the end of Jesus' life in Mark, the gospel that we've been following and really discovering who Christ is. And as I thought about it and as I prayed about it and as we were getting ready, and I knew this was Lord's Supper Sunday communion, I felt like, okay, I need to really kind of hone in on that topic, because one of the issues that took place when Jesus came on the scene was that he rendered the Old Testament temple system, sacrificial system, as obsolete. Well, he had to do that at some point in his ministry to initiate the new covenant. So in Mark 13, we have the culmination of God through Jesus, divinity who became humanity, initiating the end of the sacrificial system, and then has a discussion with his apostles about that, and then initiating within a couple days, because this all takes place within the last week of Jesus' life on earth, the new covenant of him being the sacrifice, and moving it from a system to a relationship. But God's desire, even in the Old Testament system that he established with Moses and carried through the priesthood and all the way up until Jesus, was the desire to have a relationship with people. And the last book of the Old Testament in Malachi, we see Malachi having a vision of what Jesus was going to do, what the Messiah, the Anointed One, was going to do when he came. And so we'll pick up the message there. It says, "See, I will send my messenger who will prepare the way before me." Well, we know that is John the Baptist. So Malachi is looking now 400 years into the future, and he sees that the Messiah is coming, but someone's coming before him. He says, "Then suddenly the Lord you are seeking, the one you've been waiting for, will come to his temple." So then suddenly something will happen at the temple which will identify the Messiah. "The messenger of the covenant whom you desire will come, says the Lord Almighty," the one who is to bring in the covenant. "But who can endure the day of his coming? Who can stand when he appears? For he will be like a refiner's fire or a launderer's soap." So he will come into this temple and he will be refining it, like taking the purity out of impure metals or washing something. He says, "He will sit as a refiner and a purifier of silver, and he will purify the Levites." He will change the priestly order and refine them like gold and silver. "Then the Lord will have men who will bring offerings in righteousness." He will have men, and he will have other men that will bring offerings that are pleasing to God. "And the offerings of Judah and Jerusalem will be acceptable to the Lord as in the days gone by, as in former years." So whenever you see a prophecy in Scripture, there can be multiple levels on that. It can be something that will happen in the short term, something that will happen longer term, something that can happen way in the future. So this prophecy has some things that will be way in the future, but also something will be initiated. And this is what he says, "So I will come near to you for judgment." So I'm going to come near to this temple, near to this place to judge it. "And I will be quick to testify against sorcerers, adulterers, and perjurers." Remember, Jesus called the religious leadership of the day vipers, sons of the devil. That's a sorcery right there. He said, adulterers and perjurers against those who defraud laborers of their wages, who oppress the widows and the fatherless, and deprive aliens of justice, but do not fear me, says the Lord Almighty. So we have a picture of the Messiah coming and doing something at the temple suddenly. So three things that Scripture tells us. He will be the messenger of the covenant that God desires. He will place men who will carry his message and represent the right offerings. And number three, he will judge those who were the messengers of the covenant that was in place, the religious leaders who failed to represent God rightly to the people. Now that's a big deal, because one of the problems we often have with God is, why does he allow bad things to happen? Why does God not jump in and stop everything? Well, one of the character traits you need to know about God, he is just. Payday does come. Scripture tells us it starts in the house of God. That's why Scripture says if you want to judge anybody, judge those who claim to be Jesus' followers. The world. That's why sometimes it bothers me when God's kids expect non-believers to act like believers. They're non-believers. Why would they act like Christians? They don't have the same mindset. But God will deal with them. God will deal with the injustice of the world, or else he wouldn't be a loving God. A loving God does not tolerate injustice. A loving God deals with it. That's why we are told not to seek revenge ourselves. Trust God. That's why we are to forgive, so that we can move forward in life, because unforgiveness puts us in the place of God and puts us in the place of judging, and we have not been given that place. But we are given the place to talk to one another as believers about what's going on in our lives and what do we need to do to change, be transformed by the power of the Holy Spirit in us. So Jesus initiates this in chapter 11 of Mark when he rides into Jerusalem through the east gate, through the gate of the Messiah, through the gate that was told he would ride in. He rides in on the back of a donkey, and the people for the first time are allowed to call him the Messiah, the King. Hosanna, Hosanna, they started shouting. They laid cloaks on the road for him to travel on. They put branches there so he would be separate from the dirt. This was the Messiah. He was coming, and he went straight for the temple. Suddenly, he would appear in the temple. So we pick up the story in Mark 11, 7. When they brought the colt to Jesus and threw their cloaks over it, he sat on it. Many people spread their cloaks on the road, while others spread branches they had cut in the field. And those who went ahead and those who followed shouted, Hosanna. Hosanna is a song of praise, of salvation, praise of deliverance. Thank God the Messiah is here. We are to be delivered. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Blessed is the messenger. Blessed is the coming kingdom of our father David. They got it. This is the king. He's of the lineage of David. He is the one that's going to initiate the kingdom. Hosanna in the highest. Jesus entered Jerusalem and went into temple courts. He looked around at everything, but since it was already late, he went out to Bethany with the 12. So he rides in, comes immediately to the temple, Mark tells us, and he looks around at the temple. Now the temple, the grounds of the temple covered over 10 football fields. It was a massive complex. It was made of stones that weighed anywhere from 4 tons to 30 tons on average, and they found one stone in the walls, and the walls were at least 15 feet thick surrounding the temple area, surrounding 10 football fields. And inside the temple grounds was the temple itself, which took up 2 football fields. This was a massive structure and foundation. So Jesus took his time and walked around and looked at what was going on. Why? Because he considered that his Father's house. And in fact, as Jesus was riding in, Luke gives us a little bit more insight into what was happening. In Luke 19, it says, some of the Pharisees in the crowd said to Jesus, these are the religious leaders. They're looking at Jesus and they're looking at everyone saying, he's the one, he's the Messiah, he's the anointed one. Hosanna, thank you for the kingdom is being established. They said, hey, Jesus, tell your people to stop calling you that. You're not that guy. Tell them to stop. So they said, teacher, rebuke your disciples. I tell you, he replied, if they keep quiet, the stones will cry out. If they don't say anything, the stones themselves will recognize. You guys are so dumb, you're dumber than rocks. Rocks know who I am. And you don't know who I am. And as he approached Jerusalem, so as he's coming down and approaching Jerusalem, he starts to weep over the city. Because he said this. He wept over it and said, if you, even you, had only known on this day what would bring you peace. Why is he weeping? Because he sees what will happen in 40 years when the Romans come and destroy that city and tear down the temple stone by stone to get the gold out of it. In fact, if you were up at the mount and you looked down at the temple grounds in Jerusalem, because the Mount of Olives has I believe it's about 2,000 foot drop. So you can see it would glimmer during the day because the walls had gold on them, and then the stone was so white it would look like a mountaintop on the peaks of the temple grounds. And so it was such a magnificent building and grounds. But when the Romans came and had a siege against Jerusalem in 66 AD and surrounded it with four legions, and a legion's about 6,000 soldiers or more. So we have 24,000 soldiers who put a 4-year siege on Jerusalem until they finally broke in and took it down. And then they tore the stones down because they wanted to get all the gold out of them. Jesus, as he's riding in, says, oh my God, if you guys would have only known what would have brought you peace. Because the Jews that were held up in Jerusalem for those 4 years believed they were fighting a religious war against the Roman occupiers. And Jesus said, oh, if you only known what would bring you peace. See, because when we have Jesus, we quit fighting everybody. We begin to have peace. And what is the foremost symbol of our faith? Jesus said it. He said, they will know you are my disciples by your what? Your love. Your love for one another. They will know you are different by the way you carry yourselves. And so he goes, man, if even you had known on this day what would bring you peace, but now it is hidden from your eyes. And they've been under, the Jewish people in Israel has been under a blindfold ever since that day. God's not done with them, though. He says, the days, and then he tells them what's going to happen. The days will come when your enemies will build an embankment against you and encircle you and hem you in on every side. He says, this is what's going to happen. They will dash you to the ground, you and the children within your walls. They will leave not one stone on another because you did not recognize the time of God's coming to you. He said, your religious leaders, Pharisees, who I'm talking to in this exchange here, you're the ones. You're the ones that should have been waiting for me. So I'm telling you what's going to happen. There is a judgment coming. The old system is going to be rendered obsolete. It'll be done with no more. This is going to happen in a few decades. Then he turns, and now he's going to judge the leaders. He says, you missed the day, but you've done so much more than that. You've done so much more damage. See, this is the thing with religion. Jesus was never into religion. God was not into religion. He was not into systems. He was into a relationship. The Jews were mandated from the time of Abraham to be a blessing to the nations. Sacrifice and all that stuff was designed to remove the sin so God could relate to people. The Israelite leaders, their religious leaders, were the ones who were supposed to take that to the world and open that up for everyone to enter in and to be able to have relationship with God. But these guys changed it into a system that they ran. See, religion has tremendous power. Why? Because every human being is concerned with life and death, good and evil, right and wrong. How do we live life? What is life about? And religion and religious leaders have the power to influence people in a direction and speak, so to speak, in the name of God. So with that kind of power, you can do great damage to people. In fact, a lot of us in here turned from coming to church, turned from coming and being a part of a community of believers because the church wounded you, and the leaders in particular said that, and it's not even so much what they say, it's what they do. They were hypocrites. So Jesus says the city is going to be sieged and torn. And then the temple will be not one stone on top of another. And that temple was high. It was over 100 feet high. He said it'll be torn down. And then if you read Matthew and Luke and Mark, you see Jesus turn his attention to the leaders, because they've been battling him from the beginning. They didn't want him to change anything. They liked their gig. So the next day, Jesus comes back to the temple. And Luke 19:45 gives us a little bit of insight into this. It says, when Jesus entered the temple courts, he began to drive out those who were selling. So the first thing he did was come against the way the temple system had become. It is written, he said to them, my house will be a house of prayer, but you have made it a den of robbers. Every day he was teaching at the temple, which was the last couple days of his life. But the chief priests, the teachers of the law, and the leaders among the people were trying to kill him. Yet they could not find any way to do it because all the people hung on his very words or on his words. He walked in and he sees that God's leaders, who were supposed to take care of the temple as the house that God would reside in and the place where you could commune with God, and of course, all the sacrifices that were to be done. He said, you took what was meant to be holy to God, and you've turned it into a den of robbers. You're the robbers. You are done. See, because if you're going to institute something new in your life, the old has to go. You cannot do the new and the old at the same time. When we were singing a couple minutes ago about following Jesus, that's a following Jesus. I can't follow Jesus and live my old lifestyle. He said in the temple, you guys, this was the place of God's residence, where people were supposed to come in and meet God, and you turned it into a marketplace ran by robbers. You'd rob the people. But that's not all he said to them. In Matthew 23, 13, well, let's go to Matthew 23. It speaks a lot about this. Let's go to Matthew 12. Where should I go? How much time do I got? Let's go to Mark 12, 38. So we started in Mark 11, Jesus writing, got a little bit of scripture. So I'll be jumping around the Gospels a little bit, mainly the Matthew, Mark, and Luke, because they cover this area. In Mark 12, 38, we're told this. As Jesus taught, he said, hey, watch out for the teachers of the law. They like to walk around in flowing robes and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces. And they like to have the most important seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for a show make lengthy prayers. These men will be punished most severely. I would hate to have that said about me. What was their gig? It was performance. They liked to perform holiness in front of the people. They wore the right stuff. They liked the places of honor. They liked everybody to think they were a big deal. They loved all that stuff. He said, watch out for those teachers of the law. These were the teachers. It isn't from their heart. They represented God to the people, but God was nowhere to be found. It was all about them. And Matthew 23:5 takes it to the next level. He says, everything they do is done for people to see. They make their phylacteries wide, their prayer cloths wide, and the tassels on their garments, the prayer beads. They make them nice and long to show everybody, see how much I pray? I pray a lot. He says, they love the place of honor and banquets and the most important seats. They love to be greeted with respect. Oh, Rabbi, I like that. In the marketplace and be called by Rabbi by others. They loved power and position, and they aggressively sought out the places where they could get it. Oh, there's a party? Get all dressed up in all my gear. Then I come into the party. I'm so holy. Everybody acknowledge my wonderfulness in Jesus, in God. In same chapter, verse 27, he says this, woe to you teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. Because why? They pretended to represent God to the people, but it was all about them. You are like whitewashed tombs, which are beautiful on the outside, but on the inside are full of dead men's bones and everything unclean. In the same way, on the outside you appear to people as righteous, but on the inside you are full of hypocrisy and wickedness. Now imagine hanging with Jesus and the apostles in the temple grounds saying these things to the leaders. That's why they wanted to kill him. And everybody was hanging on the words because, you know what? People aren't stupid. People saw through that. They saw who these guys were, but nobody said nothing because they had power to represent God to you. And then for them to mediate between you and God. They had great power. So we play it down, and they would collect the money. And in fact, Jesus one time says, those guys love money. They were exceedingly exact in following all the outward rules. When they would go to these banquets, they would wash their hands just like it says in Leviticus to do. And they would eat only the right food. And they would cast an eye on the people to see who was doing that or not doing that. They followed every Sabbath law. They wrote many of them. But they paid no attention to inward purity, being real and transparent and honest and open, filled with fruit, joy, and peace, and kindness, and goodness. They didn't exhibit any of that. Their hypocrisy slammed the door of heaven for themselves and anyone who was trying to get in. How many of us did not come to church for years in our life because we didn't want to be like those people? Hypocrites. One way at church. Some of us grew up in homes like that. One way at church, another way at home. One way at church, another way in business. Had a discussion with somebody once, or heard about the discussion. And this person was saying, and they had lots of money, and they were old too. They weren't going to be around a whole lot more. And they said this, you know, people say money isn't everything. Money is everything. In fact, anything good costs $500 or more. Money is everything. And this person proclaimed to be a Christian. And it was like, you're old. This person also said, you know what? Every morning I wake up, I think about how I can make more money. It's like, dude, you're old. You got this much more life. That tripped me out. That is crazy talk. You know, I think of all God's kids, we in America have some of the hardest roads to travel in following God because we have so many distractions. So many opportunities to take care of stuff ourselves. I just read the other day on news thing about this guy who was a pastor, and I forget the country, but it was somewhere in the Middle East, Libya, Syria, something. He went to do a church service, came back, and Muslims had slaughtered his kids and his wife. Can you imagine that? I was just telling Michael Heller earlier this today when I got that 20-year anniversary and being at the church and stuff, Teresa and I, and it was like I was kind of embarrassed. I didn't suffer for God. I haven't suffered. I've just had life stuff happen to me like you have life stuff happen to you. Nobody's persecuted me. I mean, I've had people say bad things about me, but that's just life. It's like we have no idea. We have no idea. Then he tells them in verse 13, "Woe to you teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites! You shut the kingdom of heaven in men's faces. You yourselves do not enter, nor will you let those enter who are trying to. Woe to you, teachers of the law and Pharisees, you hypocrites. You travel over land and sea to win a single convert, and when you have succeeded, you make them twice as much a child of hell as you are." Jesus, meek and mild. That's heavy. Said, you hinder the people. And when you take them in, you make them worse than you. Jesus summed up their leadership in three statements. In Matthew 23:16, he said this, "Woe to you, blind guides. You say if anyone swears by the temple, it means nothing. But if anyone swears by the gold of the temple, he is bound by his oath. Can you imagine making that statement? What they're basically saying, these leaders, if you swear by the temple, in other words, God, who resides in the temple, you don't even have to hold to that. But if you swear by what the temple's made of, gold, then you better keep your word. That's basically what it's saying. Jesus said to him, "You blind fools, which is greater, the gold or the temple that makes the gold sacred? You also say if anyone swears by the altar, it means nothing." The altar was the primary meeting place of God and the people, which removed their sin. He says that's not that important. But if anybody swears by the gift on it, he is bound by the oath, by the lamb or the goat or the dove. That's the important thing. He says, "You blind men, which is greater, the gift or the altar that makes the gift sacred? Therefore, he who swears by the altar swears by it and everything on it." He says, you got it all backward. You guys are blind. You're blind guides. He said, "You mislead rather than lead. You blind fools, you have wrong thinking. You blind men, you're the feeblest of men." When you're blind, and if I took you out of this building and put you on the street, you would be the feeblest of a person. You'd not know where to go. He goes, "You guys are that. You're just blind men. You don't even know what you're doing." He says, "You don't even understand the value of the temple. You think it's in the things. It's who resides in the temple." So Jesus is telling these guys these things, and Matthew and Luke give us a number of more statements he makes against them. Then one day, we get into Mark 13, and as the disciples are leaving to go back up to the Mount of Olives, they start talking about how awesome the temple is, how beautiful. It says in Mark 13:1, as Jesus was leaving the temple, one of his disciples said to him, "Look, teacher, what massive stones." And like I said, the average stone weighed 10 tons. "What magnificent buildings." Jesus responded in verse 2, "Do you see all these great buildings?" replied Jesus. "Not one stone will be left on another. Every one will be thrown down." They're listening to this. Second time now, Jesus has made this statement. So the disciples go with Jesus up to that Mount of Olives, and they're sitting there, and they say, "Hey, Jesus, what in the world is going on here?" As Jesus was sitting on the Mount of Olives opposite the temple, so they could look down at the temple, Peter, James, John, and Andrew asked him privately, "Hey, tell us when these things will happen, and what will be the sign that they are all about to be fulfilled?" Mark takes the slant of, "Tell us when's this going to happen? You said it's all going to be thrown down? And how will we know when that's going to happen?" Matthew takes us more into the future, but Mark says his guys are concerned with, "Dude, that's a mind blower. You've messed up our whole world of thinking. Hey, let me tell you something. When you follow Jesus, your whole world of thinking gets messed up. Your whole world of understanding how God should roll, how things should play out, they get wrecked. You'll get wrecked too. These guys are wrecked. First of all, he told me he was going to die, but he's going to raise again. Then he's telling them the whole thing's going to be their whole way of life. Their whole religious system's coming to an end." So Jesus starts to talk to them, and this is a private council with Jesus and his guys. You and I, 2,000 years later, get to sit in on a private talk. Jesus said to them, "Watch out that no one deceives you. Many will come in my name claiming I am he and will deceive many. When you hear of wars and rumors of wars, don't be alarmed. Such things must happen, but the end is still to come." So when you hear about wars and rumors of wars and stuff like that, don't worry. That's not the end. In fact, Matthew says it's birth pangs. It's like contractions. you're going to be in it for a while longer. What do? Anytime we hear rumors of war, we panic. What do you tell them? Don't be alarmed. And he didn't say, this is a suggestion. Don't trip on it too much. He says, don't be alarmed. He's talking to his guys right here. They asked him, when is the stuff you just said going to happen, and what's the sign? Well, he just said, those aren't the signs. And then he said this, nation will rise against nation, and kingdom will rise against, or kingdom against kingdom. There will be earthquakes in various places and famines, and these are the beginning of birth pains. That's not it either. He says, listen, you're living in a Roman time when peace, Pax Roma, the peace of Rome, covers the land. Things are going to happen. You're going to see stuff happen. Don't worry about it. I'm still in charge. You still have a job. Keep on trucking. He says, listen, natural disasters, they're going to happen. It was interesting to me. Some guy wrote about a natural disaster that had happened, I don't know, somewhere, some hurricane, previous hurricane. He's talking about that was the wrath of God on the people of that area for being sinners and the wrath of God. Well, the latest hurricane just hit his hometown and destroyed his house. But wait, now it's a natural disaster. That's the problem. There are natural disasters. God can do wrathful things. He can come and judge. He can do whatever he wants. But he said, don't trip on those things. Then he tells his guys in verse 9, you must be on your guard because you will be handed over to the local councils and flogged in the synagogues. And on account of me, you will stand before governors and kings as witnesses to them. He said, a bunch of stuff's going to happen to you, but don't worry. It gives you an opportunity to witness. You know, you and I in this country, we get the opposite of it. A lot of us have stories and histories where a lot of stuff happened to us. We come into Jesus, he cleans us and redeems us and changes us, and we get to witness about that. He's telling these guys that you'll go before the government. These guys didn't know within 3 days Jesus would be before the leaders. And he will be a witness to Pilate and to Herod. They didn't know that the Jews would take him in a couple nights. And he would be a witness before them. So he tells them, hey guys, you're going to go through that same thing, but don't worry. It gives you an opportunity to witness. And then he says, listen, the gospel must be preached to all nations. Whenever you, and then the key word here is first. He goes, listen, this is going to go on. And the key thing here is the gospel first will be preached to all nations. Matthew tells us that the gospel will be preached to all nations, then the end comes. You know, there, and the word nations means ethnic groups. It means people who are of a culture that speaks a particular language and has their own culture. He says that will be the major sign that the end is here, is when they get preached to. In fact, Revelation says angels will be carrying on some of that duty. Some of us in here have had angels appear, have had encounters with supernatural beings in part of our coming to the Lord. Well, that's going to increase too. So, did I skip some verses? Nope. Okay. And then he says this, whenever you are arrested and brought to trial, do not worry beforehand about what to say. This Jesus and this whole thing about don't worry. Doesn't it bug you when he tells you, you know what? It's all going to heck in a handbasket. Here's how you get through it. Don't worry. Don't even worry about what you're to say when you're before these people. He says, just say what is given you at the time, for it is not you speaking, but the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit will give you what you need to say when you're in front of people. You don't have to rely on your abilities. Because isn't that the way we are a lot of times when God puts us in front of someone and we feel, well, you know, I'd like to share a little bit about God, but, you know, I don't have 14 of the, you know, 60 books memorized even yet. I don't even know that many verses. You don't have to. Holy Spirit will give you what you need to say. Don't worry about it. He says this, brother will betray brother, a father a child, children will rebel against their parents and have them put to death. Everyone will hate you because of me. But the one who stands firm to the end will be saved. He says, listen, guys, you're going to face trouble. He says, I understand being placed in front of the Roman government. See, there was something these guys were going to face. They were going to be persecuted. Why? Because if they claim Jesus as Lord, as God, the Jewish religious leaders will come against that. Because their belief is in Deuteronomy 6:4 that the Lord God is one. So claiming Jesus is blasphemy in their eyes, and that's one of the reasons they hated Jesus to start with. They consider that blasphemy. So he said, you guys are going to face that persecution from the Jewish. Then you're going to face persecution from the Romans. Why? Because the Romans believe Caesar is Lord. And once a year, you had to do some kind of incense, some type of thing proclaiming Caesar is Lord. So when you deny Caesar is Lord and you say Jesus is Lord, you are going to come under problems with the Roman government. See, to you and I, that's kind of a foreign concept. But the way our country's going, we might have some problems proclaiming Jesus is Lord because our government is moving more and more towards government is Lord. And he says, listen, even your family that's devoted to you and loves you, and especially you guys following me, you 12 apostles, you're Jews. Your Jewish family who isn't converted to the Lord is going to have a problem when it comes to, do I stand with the ancient faith or do I stand with my family? There will be betrayals going on. But don't worry about it. It's all good. It all works out. The end. Let's pray. Then the next portion of Mark, which we don't have time to get into right now, deals with the Lord going to deal again with the Israelites and the Jewish leaders and what he's going to do to restore that. And then ultimately, God's judgment on the nations. But God's big plan over all of that is that the gospel is going to be preached. So Peter tells us, as he writes in his last letter, 30-something years later, he says this, don't forget this one thing, dear friends. With the Lord, a day is like 1,000 years, and 1,000 years are like a day. The Lord is not slow in keeping his promise, as some understand slowness. Instead, because why previously he said people are saying, hey, where is this returning of your God? Where is this returning of Jesus? He goes, hey, God's not slow. He didn't all of a sudden get, hey, I don't know what I'm doing. I'm slow. He said he's not that kind of a God. He says this is what he's doing. Instead, he is patient with you, not wanting anyone to perish, but everyone to come to repentance. Same thing Jesus said to Peter 30-something years ago, that the gospel needs to go out to all the nations. So, you want to know what's holding Jesus back? It ain't 666. It ain't any of that stuff. What holds Jesus back is he wants people to come to him. And even though he rendered that system obsolete, He is still working to do that in temples. He took a building temple, and Paul speaks much about this, and transferred it to human beings as living temples. That is your mission on this planet. You are a living stone. I'll read you some verses here. But you are a living stone inhabited by God, just like his desire was for the old temple. He has transferred that to living temples, so that everywhere we go, we represent God. And Peter tells us we're all priests. We are all priests. We are the ones that now represent God. That old system, obsolete. The new system, one sacrifice for all time. Then we are being made holy. We are going, as Chris said, and God is maturing us. But the big picture is, it ain't about how much money you can make. You leave it all. And the only thing I can say about the rapture is this. Well, I could say a lot, but you guys that worry about the rapture, if you die, you're raptured. And everybody up to this point has been raptured already that has died. So you're going to go to God one way or the other. His plan, outside of what I just shared with you, is to do something with his people that he called way back in the time of Abraham, who still walk around in blindness. So there's a bunch of stuff God's going to do with them, and that's still there. You and I, as followers of Jesus, we're part of that family, but we have been given a job. Listen to what Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 3:16. He says, listen, don't you know that you yourselves are God's temple? And that God's Spirit dwells in your midst or in you? He says, listen, I was a Pharisee. I got the system. I understood the whole old system. But what I'm telling you is this. And Peter writes at the end of what I began to read you. He writes, you know what? These things I'm sharing with you about the Lord wanting everybody to reach. He goes, Paul writes about it too, but he writes some stuff that's hard to understand. This is Peter talking about Paul. He goes, he writes some things. It's kind of like gobbledygook. And this is way before John had his vision about Revelation. So these were progressive understandings of what God is going to do. But Paul writes a very succinct thing here. He says, you guys need to understand that if you have the Lord, you are a walking temple. Instead of stationary and people coming to you, you are a mobile temple going everywhere you go. You represent God. That makes you a priest. And you know what that means? You have an accountability. You have an accountability. Don't misrepresent him. He wasn't too happy with the other leaders. I want him to be overjoyed with you. He says this, don't you know that you yourself are God's temple and that God's Spirit dwells in your midst? If anyone destroys God's temple, God will destroy that person. So he goes, listen, anybody messes with you and destroys you, they got to answer to me. I'm the only one that gets to destroy temples. And I get to build them. He says, for God's temple is sacred, and you together are that temple. 1 Corinthians 6, he tells us this. Do you not know that your bodies are temples of the Holy Spirit? Again, who is in you? The Holy Spirit is in us. That's why when we go and do life, the Holy Spirit will give you what you say. The Holy Spirit will convict you and convince you of what to do. You guys following me on all this? He says, whom you have received from God, you are not your own. You were bought with a price, the price of Jesus. You were taken in. Therefore, honor God with your bodies. You have a job to do. It isn't being old and waking up in the morning and see how much money you can make. I know we need money. Don't get me wrong. I know that life goes on. But your mission is bigger than that. In Ephesians 2:19, Paul takes it to another level. He says, consequently, because of what Jesus did previously, you are no longer foreigners and strangers, but fellow citizens with God's people and also members of his household. You belong to God. You are members. We get to do what they failed at. They failed to represent the Lord well to the world so people could come in. He says, you, however, do it differently. You don't need to worry about injustice done to you. You need to be an example of forgiveness. You need to let bygones be bygones. You need to change those things that hinder. And you can't do it on your own. The Holy Spirit living in you does that. Why? Because you've got a mission. You got a mission, and it ain't football, gentlemen. It ain't. That's a side gig. Because if you did have a mission, you wouldn't be sitting here, you'd be playing. Right? If that was your temple place to be, you'd be there. It's okay to watch stuff. It's okay to watch TV. It's okay to enjoy that stuff. Don't make it your life's mission, man. It's a waste of time. I've followed Kobe for many years. Never has called me once. I've never gone to his house and coded to cause it. Kobe! Yeah, it's Joe Fury. Biggest fan. Love you. Can I come in and hang out? I'd be escorted away. But I'll tell you what, the people in your spheres of influence, that is your mission field. And don't be the type of guy that they'll look at or gal that'll look at you as a hypocrite. Carry yourself with the dignity of a representative, an ambassador of God to a dying, hurting, blinded world. Okay. I'll read you one last thing and we'll go. Mark 13:32. Finish up with Mark. He says, but about that day or hour, about when God's going to do all his fulfilling stuff, not even the angels in heaven, no one knows, not even the angels in heaven nor the Son, but only the Father. That's the Father's business. Yeah, we can look at stuff, but it's really his business. Be on guard, be alert, be aware. Keep your eyes watchful. You do not know when that time will come. It is like a man going away. He leaves his house and put his servants in charge, us, each with their assigned task, whatever your tasks are, and tells the one at the door to keep watch. He says, listen, I am to be about my business and watchful that the Lord's coming. Always with that in mind. Why? Because if I don't keep my head up and watch, it gets down and stuff. I think cell phones are from the enemy, so we keep our heads down. Now that's blasphemy, Joe. Let's pray. Can we stand up? How many know that you're a temple of God, that you are a living stone, that you belong to the kingdom? How many know that God has tasks for you to do as a mobile temple who's filled with the Holy Spirit, who has a job to do, and that the new system God is operating in, you're part of? How many know that you'll be held accountable for that? Not your salvation. That was done with Jesus. Paul calls them rewards. There's something to be rewarded for serving God well. How many want the rewards that God has for you to serve him well? Man, if you don't have your hand up for that, I don't even know what to tell you. So let's just pray. Lord God, I just pray for my brothers and sisters here as living stones put together as the new temple. and that we have a job to do here. And we know, God, you will come back someday and reign. We know that you have a call and you have a purpose in these times we live in. We know that you are bringing everything to fulfillment for you to be King of Kings and Lord of Lords in every way. And we are on board with that. So God, in the different tasks we have as those living stones, let us do them well. Let us represent you well. And Lord God, we can't wait to see you. We can't wait to see our King. And we cry out like they did when you rode that donkey, Hosanna in the highest. Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. Let us be the ones that come in your name to our spheres of influence. Let us bring that deliverance that they're looking for, that hope that they're longing for, that bigger picture that they don't get, right in our spheres of influence. And Lord, we welcome you to come back any moment. How many want him to come back? That'll be a good day. Imagine coming up, flying up, and seeing the Lord. We're going to go there one way or the other, but, you know, tomorrow's cool. And we pray all this in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen.